This one tool could completely change the game of math teaching, the board. Teachers use it every day, but they don't use it as well as they could, and it's hurting their students. If your math class experiences have been anything like mine, the board work has likely felt like this: messy, overwhelming, confusing, total math overload. Or maybe you're a math teacher and you feel guilty about how unorganized your board work is. Well, today is your lucky day, because I happen to be both a mathematics educator and a graphic designer. And in today's video, we're going to talk about my master's thesis, where I studied the effect well-designed board work has on both students and teachers. And let me tell you, the findings were both shocking and impressive. My name is Jennifer, and I am one of the co-founders of this channel, Math the World. I studied mathematics education for both my undergraduate and graduate degree at Brigham Young University, but also minored in graphic design and worked as one for 3 years. I've always loved both my art and my STEM classes. I get this from my dad. So when it came time to pick a thesis topic, I knew I had to choose something that incorporated both. I began thinking about my own experiences in math classes and how frustrated I often felt with the board work. I consider myself a visual learner, so board work is very important to how I learn math. And I think a lot of students can relate. But good board work isn't about just writing neatly. Good board work has the potential to help students make meaningful connections in math. And this is all done by using elements and principles of design. You see, design is a powerful tool that shapes the way you intake information. The design of a movie poster can make you want to see that movie or not. The design of a website can make it easy and intuitive to navigate, or so frustrating you leave in seconds. And in math classes, a well-designed board can help students better understand the material and make connections across it, or it can hinder their learning by creating cognitive overload. I'll dive into the design principles next, but first I want to briefly talk about what country is already excelling in well-designed board work. Japan. In Japan, teachers don't just plan lessons, they plan board work. This practice, called bansho, involves carefully planning what goes on the board to guide students' learning and often takes up several pages in their lesson plans. The Japanese recognize that the board is not just a writing tool, but a teaching tool. Japanese teachers plan out how the board will model good note-taking, effectively summarize the lesson, and facilitate students in making connections across ideas. But bansho isn't about spoon-feeding answers. The board work gives structure, while still encouraging students to think independently and engage with the material. But while Japanese research has shared a lot on good board work practices, none of it has been very specific about the actual principles of design in use. And this is the research gap I aimed to fill. Within the design world, you have elements and principles. You can think of elements as the tools to create art, and the principles are how you use those tools to create art. Gestalt principles tell us how we then perceive the art, and layout and data visualization are larger frameworks on which these elements and principles are applied. With my background in graphic design and years of experience teaching with boards, I selected these 5 design principles for board work in math classes. Let's dive in. First, the grouping perceptions from the principles of Gestalt: similarity, proximity, and common region. When your eyes look at an image like this, there are a number of groups it automatically forms. Not necessarily in this order, but first, it notices that there are 2 main groups, the one on the left and the one on the right. It has grouped these together because of the close proximity of the shapes. 2, your brain starts to look for patterns within those groups, like the columns, because they are also in proximity and of similar shape. 3, it groups the items of similar color together, even though they are not all the same shape. But something about the fact that they're all in orange means that there must be something connected about them, right? These principles of similarity and proximity tell us that things that look similar or are in close proximity will be grouped together in our minds, and we will automatically associate them together and look for connections between them. Lastly, your brain also notices these 2 objects boxed together at the bottom. Since these objects are contained in a common region, your brain also says there must be some connection between them. Next, layout. This consists of deciding beforehand which space to dedicate to certain ideas. This example here shows the layout some teachers in Japan use daily when writing on their boards. They have dedicated space for stating the problem, showing multiple examples of student work, recording comments from the class discussion, and writing up the final answer and conclusions. Next is hierarchy. Hierarchy is a way of identifying what is most important in a composition and separating out all the different parts. This principle helps guide our eyes when lots of information is presented to us in one image. As seen here, the image on the left utilizes design elements such as size and weight to tell us what things in the image are most important and where our eyes should go first, second, and third. The image on the right, however, does not utilize any of these elements, which makes knowing where to look difficult as the message becomes lost in the uniformity. Next, the principle of repetition is the repeated use of an element or principle of design. Teachers can create repetition by setting a color scheme for their board work, always using the same colors to highlight, emphasize, or box off areas of the board, or by using a consistent layout each day as mentioned above with the Japanese lessons so that students know which areas of the board will generally hold certain types of information. Lastly, representations. They're not so much a principle of design, but an entire subfield of graphic design called data visualization, which utilizes principles like those mentioned above to create visual representations of data that presents the information in a clear and concise format. For example, if you were trying to compare and contrast two data sets, would you use pie charts or bar charts? Bar charts is the clear choice. Even though the colors in the pie chart are in the same order, the varying sizes make it difficult to compare one value to the other. The bar charts, on the other hand, show the differences between these two data sets more clearly and makes it easier to decipher the differing trends. The basis for my theory is that our brains like simplicity and order. According to Gestalt theory, our brains strive for understanding and want things to be organized. They naturally look for connections and patterns in order to simplify information input. When things are disorganized, it is easy for students to experience cognitive overload. There's just too much happening all at once, and they struggle to make the necessary connections to simplify all of the data their brains are trying to work through. So my theory is that by applying design principles to board work in a math classroom, we can lower the cognitive load for students, making it easier for them to understand and make connections across the content. In order to test this theory, I devised a study with an experiment group and a control group. I sought out a college trigonometry teacher, we'll call her Brooke, and observed her teach three trigonometry lessons fall semester and surveyed her students afterwards. Then I spent the rest of that semester teaching her these design principles and observed her implementing them in class and giving feedback. Then in winter semester, I observed her teach those same three trig lessons to a new group of students and surveyed those students with the same survey questions as before. I also interviewed Brooke throughout this process to understand the impact board work planning had on her as well. My findings were both expected and unexpected. I expected students' responses to improve from fall semester to winter semester, and they did. Across many of the questions I asked, I saw statistically significant improvement that shows student cognitive loads were lightened by implementing these design principles. I had questions that asked students to self-report how easy it was to determine what was most important, hierarchy, and how difficult it was to recognize and link crucial information, grouping perceptions. And both questions saw statistically significant improvement from fall to winter semester. And for other questions, I showed students a portion of the board work and asked them to recall what had been taught, and also saw a statistically significant increase in correct answers between semesters. It became very evident very quickly that students definitely notice the board and have a lot to say about it. With many of the questions, I had students also justify their responses, and let me tell you, they went off. I was shocked to see just how well students recognize these design principles without actually knowing or being able to name them. Saying things like, it is all in the same color, in the same style, so it can be hard to tell what is the best info to take notes on sometimes. A classic example of hierarchy. Or picking up on the grouping perceptions of proximity by saying, sometimes the board seems unorganized and I get the formulas messed up. It seems at times they are too close together and one can't tell where they start or end. I overall found statistical significance with 4 of the 5 board work design principles. You can read about these findings in depth using the link to my thesis below. And while I expected a decrease in students' cognitive loads, I did not expect a decrease in the teacher's cognitive load too. I interviewed Brooke several times throughout the study, and a repeated theme she brought up after learning and implementing these principles was how board work planning offloaded organizational tasks that were often burdensome to her while teaching. In this way, planning her board work freed up space in her working memory, lightening her cognitive load, and allowing her to focus on more important parts of her teaching practice while in the moment of teaching. But I think the most shocking finding of this study was how students' perceptions of their teacher changed. It was something I had not anticipated at all. Fall semester was not Brooke's first time teaching trigonometry, and in past semesters, she'd had issues with student complaints. I interviewed her about midway through winter semester, and she said by this point, she usually has a very vocal group and not happy with her teaching style. She even likened them to a mutiny or revolt. But in the semester where she implemented these design principles, she had gotten no complaints, and she felt that the addition of these design principles was the biggest difference. In her words, she felt that planning her board work makes it clear that she has a plan and that it's going to be visually clear how it all comes together. So not only can well-planned board work lower student cognitive load and aid them in learning and making connections, but it also impacts the perceived quality of instruction by communicating the effort you've put into the lesson plan. Lastly, I want to go over an explicit example to show how these principles can be applied to mathematical board work. Take a look at this image first. Pause here to study it and see if you can deduce what the topic of discussion was. Knowing our design principles, also try to pick out what principles are being used or how these principles could be better applied. If you guessed arc length, you would be correct. And if you guessed the two different ways to calculate arc length, you would be doubly correct. But if you were one of Brooke's students that watched this lesson fall semester, you would be among the few 4% that correctly recalled that the discussion was on the two ways to calculate arc length. So what's going wrong? Here, I would identify issues with layout, grouping, and representations. There are two calculations happening, here and here. But because the layout has placed them vertically, it feels like they are all part of one continuing calculation. Vertical layouts often make it difficult to compare and contrast two methods like this. To fix this, she could rearrange the board and place these two methods side by side instead. Next, grouping. It might have been easier to distinguish these two methods, even vertically, if there had been more spacing between them. But because of the close proximity and similarity with using the same color, it makes the viewer believe this is all one example. To fix this, she could give plenty of space when placing them side by side, and could even consider using different colors for each method. Lastly, representations. They had a great class discussion summarizing the differences between these methods and how one uses the percent of the circle times the circumference, while the other uses the percent of the radius times the length. And these generalized ideas did not make it up on the board. To fix this, we could break down each formula, labeling what each part of the answer represents generally. This would provide a stronger representation that we would hope makes it into students' notes for future reference. After discussing how to improve this board work, Brooke drew this instead winter semester. When I surveyed her new students and asked what had been discussed here, 38% correctly recalled that they had talked about the two different ways to calculate arc length. A very statistically significant result. I have many more examples of board work changes in my thesis linked below, and I will also link my PowerPoint slides from a conference talk I gave if you'd like a more summarized version of my thesis, but a more detailed version than this video here. I hope this video reaches a lot of math teachers, so if you are a teacher, please share with your teacher friends and leave a comment on your thoughts. And if you are a student who has a math teacher, find a way to share this with them so they can better their teaching practice. Let us know in the comments about your board work experiences in math classes, and which of these principles you think would be most helpful.
Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.